On the 1st of October, 1983, Neil Kinnock was elected leader of the Labour Party. Kinnock and his wife offered a fresh image for a party which was still reeling from a crushing election defeat that year. Here at last, it seemed, was the hope of a new start for Labour and an end to the years of civil war.
The day that I was elected leader of the Labour Party was a day that mixed a certain amount of excitement with a disproportionate amount of fear for me. First of all, I had the short-term alarm at having to get up and make a brief speech for which I had made no preparation whatsoever. And then secondly, there was this great Alp to climb. Our standing in the polls at that time was 24%. And so it was essential to manifest enthusiasm and to say thanks to my friends and to Glenys and everybody else. But deep down, right inside my stomach, I had great pterodactyls flapping. I mean, I was terrified.
I'll never forget the moment he went up to the platform at the 1983 party conference to make his acceptance speech to the conference. He'd been working on it for a day and a half beforehand, very tense about getting it right, and the idea he hadn't worked on it was ludicrous. But he turned to me and said to me, grabbing my lapels, and said, Charles, today of all days I've got nothing to say to the conference. And he felt that. He felt that he had nothing to say to them. Then, of course, he'd delivered a speech which was magnificent.
Just remember, all times in all temptations, how you, each and every single one of you sitting in this hall, each and every Labour worker watching this conference, each and every Labour voter, yes, and some other ones as well, remember how you felt on that dreadful morning of June the 10th. Just remember how you felt then and think to yourselves, June the 9th, 1983, never, ever again will we experience that.
Roy Hattersley was Labour's choice as deputy. The party's left had made peace with the right to create the so-called Dream Ticket. In 1983, Kinnock was regarded as a man of the left, but his leadership would take him far from the radical socialism of his youth.
What is clear about Neil's leadership is, one, that had he not held these views on Europe, on public ownership, on defence, he would not have been elected leader. Two, since he held those views, he could not be made Prime Minister. Third, if he changed those views, whatever the reason, he was going to be accused of cutting his cloth in order to wear a suit which won him the election. From the moment he became leader, those views almost condemned him to lose the election, either A, because he held the views, or B, because he changed his mind. It was a very unhappy situation for him to be in.
Neil was not a man who was short of ideas. This was the tragedy, in a sense. And if Neil had only been allowed to develop his own ideas and to express them, as I think he could have done, he was the best platform orator in the country on his day, then I think he could have provided tremendous political leadership. I don't say he was perfect. I mean, Neil had many faults. But I think he was persuaded into a strategy, both personal and political, which didn't allow him to play to his own strengths.
Well, I think he was elected by the Parliamentary Party as a man with a reputation on the left in order to deal with the left. If you have left credentials, you have to prove for the rest of your life that you're no longer a part of that. You have then to accommodate to the right. I mean, that is a fact of politics, of Labour politics in particular.
Neil Kinnock was the son of a miner from the Welsh Valleys, and in the years before he became leader, he presented himself as the spiritual heir to the great Welsh radical Aneurin Bevan. He argued against Britain's membership of the common market. He supported CND, and he'd backed Tony Benn's campaign for change in the Labour Party.
Neil Kinnock hadn't had time at that stage to mature politically. And the views that he then expressed were the fashionable views of the soft stroke hard left. So he was against nuclear weapons, in favor of unilateral nuclear disarmament. The whole Benite rigmarole of doctrines was embraced by Neil Kinnock. But they weren't really what he had thought himself through to believing. And the following decade, almost, of Kinnock's leadership is a gradual unraveling of these old positions which he had so easily adopted and which were so popular then in the Labour Party.
Before he became leader, Neil Kinnock had always been popular with journalists. He was affable and unpretentious, and always good for a quote or a story.
Tell you what, do you want a real school?
Go on then.
I'll walk on the water. How about that?
I personally think there was a need to try and plant Kinnock as a statesman type person in the voters' minds, because the tabloids in particular, and some of the things that he did himself, had planted him in the minds of the electorate as something less than a statesman. When you look back, you know, it's quite funny, you see the video of Neil and Glenys falling over on the beach at the party conference. I thought at the time, what a nice thing, you know. What a human thing to happen. Yet I could never imagine Tony Blair falling over on the beach with his wife.
Well, when he first became leader, he was very, very witty, very funny, very exuberant, bubbling over and very spontaneous. And I remember we'd take him to, you know, photo calls and things, and on one occasion he picked up somebody's umbrella and he started singing.
La, 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 la.
That's all we
singing in the rain. Just singing in the rain.
And the Daily Mirror ran that photograph on the front page the next day, which we were less than thrilled about.
Happy again.
I got crucified. And it didn't matter to me very much, but it damaged the movement. It damaged the cause. And I thought, well, not dancing in the street and singing funny songs is not much of a sacrifice to make for the advance of the Labour movement. So I did become more constrained after that.
Kinnock's new role demanded more than the ability to mingle with the party faithful. In an effort to make himself appear more dignified, he turned to a group of young men and women from outside the party machine.
I think it's important to bear in mind that we certainly felt, and some think we were overly nervous about this, that the media in general was very hostile to Labour and hostile to Neil in particular, and that pictures, for example, of him swinging that beer would be used and transmitted very widely throughout the country. And indeed, when they occurred, they were. And so we sought to avoid situations where those types of pictures would arise.
Neil Kinnock had easy charm on the hustings.
I'm sorry to lumber you with all this.
And you. And during the 83 election campaign, he'd been happy to use photo opportunities to promote his own career.
There you go. Are you going to sit back there?
But his seemingly effortless rise aroused suspicions among some of his colleagues.
Well, he was young, largely untried, seen perhaps as slightly opportunistic, I would guess, seen as very ambitious. And I think, therefore, there was a feeling on the right, which never disappeared, that Neil had somehow got the leadership undeservedly, or had fluked it in some way, and wasn't really up to it. And that persisted in various forms throughout Neil's leadership, I think.
Neil was what you might call a checklist soft-left member of the Labour Party. He seemed to go with all the easy popular policies. He is such a delightful man that he was liked by thousands and thousands of activists in the Labour Party, and he liked being liked. There's no doubt about it.
Hey, Jim! All right.
He really liked being liked. What happened to Neil was that he realised that being Prime Minister was more important than being liked.
Everybody liked Neil Kinnock until he became leader of the Labour Party. And suddenly people turned against him. And he found it very difficult to adjust to being unpopular. I remember Dennis Healy saying to me that he and I had had 20 years of having an unpleasant fluid poured all over us. Dennis was slightly more graphic than that. And we really got used to being immersed in this unpleasant substance. Neil hadn't had it before, and it takes some getting used to.
Many felt Roy Hattersley was better suited to be leader. Hattersley was an accomplished journalist and writer, at ease with the influential London liberal establishment. It was a world which never warmed to Neil Kinnock.
That is my final word of thanks to all of you for coming. Michael, I'm deeply grateful that you should be here. To have the honour of having the second best journalist in the Parliamentary Labour Party with us this evening is an immense privilege, and I am, as well as that, seriously grateful that you should come here.
And I think certainly in the early days, on both sides, there were quite a number of strains. I heard Neil refer disparagingly to Roy, and I also once overheard a comment in which someone said to him, you did terribly well, why not let Neil get on looking after the party?
Yes, well, that's useful. No, this Labour values your values. That's
and good. You represent the party to the country, as it were, and that was the sentiment expressed. But in my view, there was always a separate long-term agenda to which Roy and others were working. They were very keen to ensure the succession to one of them, as it were, and I think they always felt that Neil was a necessity that had to be put up with rather than a wholehearted colleague.
Well, I suppose that my abilities, and one of the main reasons that I became elected leader of the Labour Party, lie in the field of being a mobiliser, an advocate, an articulator, an enthuser. Roy's attributes are perhaps more cerebral. And I could, I guess, defend the difference on the basis that in order for a body to have life, it needs a heart and a stomach and a backbone, as well as a brain.
I think he was lacking in confidence. He was, in public, he was a hail fellow, well met, full of bonhomie and so on.
University of Wales, Prif Ysgol Cymru.
But as a private person, I think he was assailed by all sorts of self-doubt. But he was, I think, very quickly got at by the attacks mounted on him by the right-wing press. They quickly found out how to get under his skin. And it was on this intellectual lightweight business.
Well, I guess I've been told so many times by so many people in so many articles in so many newspapers that I was stupid, that maybe I believed a little bit of it.
Shortly after Kinnock became leader, Tony Benn was returned to Westminster at the Chesterfield by-election. The campaign brought the two men face to face in a show of unity.
I personally had no hopes for Neil Kinnock at all, because I had had an opportunity of seeing him at work in the previous years, and he was selected really for the purpose of carrying on the destruction of the left, I think. And of course it wasn't very long before he changed his position on the miners, for example, which he'd strongly supported before, on Europe, which where he'd been opposed to our entry into the community, on nuclear weapons and so on.
You're going to listen to me, or the
other? Yes, no.
Okay. Neil Kinnock had publicly opposed Tony Benn's campaign for the deputy leadership. Now, as leader, he was determined to eradicate Benn's remaining influence within the party. Despite the friendly smiles in public,
this is cozy, isn't it?
The two men were to remain bitter enemies.
Neil did decide to lead the party away from the kind of Bennite left position, which he, of course, had shared for many years in the late 1970s. and to lead it towards a more centralist position. That inevitably meant that Tony Benn either had to go along with it or he had to stand out. I mean, to Tony Benn's credit, he stood by what he believed the principled position to be.
When you elected me to Chesterfield last year, they didn't elect me there to sit and watch Mrs. Thatcher destroy the lives of working people in Chesterfield. They sent me there to fight for them.
And it's here we go, for the women of the working.
To Benn and the left, Kinnock's first act of treachery was not to give his wholehearted backing to the miners in their struggle with Margaret Thatcher's government.
The miners' strike was handled disastrously. Whatever view you took of its origins, the fact is it was a fight. It was clearly a fight to the death. It was the single most important moment in the 1980s. It was a turning point. In a war of that kind, you don't try and sit on the fence or walk down the middle of the road, because as Nye Bevan said, if you walk down the middle of the road, you get run over by both sides. And that, of course, is exactly what happened. And it was, I remember the Archbishop of Canterbury managed to get to a picket line before Neil did.
The nature of the strike, its poor timing, and the fact that it was called without a full ballot made it seem a hopeless cause.
Keep moving.
No.
You keep moving.
No.
Keep moving.
No. No.
And Arthur Scargill's unyielding militancy conveyed an image of Labour which Neil Kinnock was desperate to change.
No way.
Listen, no.
No way.
Listen.
No way.
You're blocking up.
But Kinnock and Labour could not easily break with the past.
Neil always believed that we could not criticise the Scargill decision simply because the Labour Party does not criticise trade unions and trade union leaders when trade union leaders are under threat from the government of their employers. It wasn't cowardice, it wasn't timidity, it was, if you need to have a critical word, it was sentiment. The Labour Party does not criticise workers on strike. We should have criticised them much earlier.
Neil Kinnock was paralysed by the miners' strike. As the dispute wore on, he half-heartedly visited a Welsh picket. He was neither able to condemn nor condone, agonising on the sidelines, while Arthur Scargill and Margaret Thatcher fought the battle to the death.
If that mandate had been sought, if they'd had a ballot, the whole political circumstances would have been radically altered. And there was I, confronted by that reality. But also, suffering my own, not to overstate it, emotional turmoil because of my associations with the mining industry, with miners and their families, with my own family. And my desire at all times to see that they weren't further demoralized whilst knowing that they were heading straight into disaster. And I suppose it meant that I didn't clarify in my own mind a strategy as clearly and as quickly as I should have.
The test, really, the ultimate test, is not whether your ideology is fine or your rhetoric's good, but whose side are you on when the going gets rough? And by that test he failed, and failed terribly. And it's the miners fought on, and they continued to support the Labour Party, but they were decimated. And at the moment they needed help from the Labour leadership, they didn't get it.
The defeat of the miners left a residue of bitterness, even hatred, within the Labour movement. But it confirmed Kinnock in his determination to embark on a high-profile attack on the hard left within his own party, above all, the Trotskyite militant tendency.
Neil's tactic for dealing with the dissentients in their body was to detach the hard left, or as he would have called them, the illegitimate left, from the acceptable left within the Labour Party. He was, after all, a part of the acceptable left, and believed that they were the heart and soul of the Labour Party, and was certainly not going to do anything to damage them. But he was offended, I think, by the way their policies were being damaged by the illegitimate left, people who he believed had really no place in a democratic socialist movement.
I moved from a position in the very early 80s of believing that militant were a flaming nuisance but were handleable to actually being convinced that they were a dangerous faction that were actually undermining the Labour Party, that they were a maggot in our midst. Tackling them was crucial, not merely in terms of convincing the electorate that we were electable and that we were a party that was in tune with them, but also in rooting out thuggery and bullying and the kind of anti-socialist behaviour which I discovered in Liverpool.
For years, the Liverpool Labour Party had been moribund, the fiefdom of an old-style Labour town hall mafia. As the city declined and social problems intensified, the militant tendency found fertile ground for recruitment. By 1985, the council was militant controlled and committed to revolutionary overthrow of the established order.
Our position was that capitalism could no longer, and in fact that's been the position for decades, is incapable now of meeting the needs of the mass of the working people in this country, and indeed on a global scale, but particularly in Britain. You're only have to look at the lengthening dole queues, the appalling conditions that aged people lived in, the fact that in some areas of Liverpool, on some of the council estates, youth unemployment was in the region of 90%, 9-0.
Militants enjoyed a great deal of support locally. However, when senior figures in the Labour Party visited the city, they found ready ammunition for the leadership's campaign against the tendency.
They totally and completely used the Labour Party in the most sinister way to get what they wanted. In fact, some of the things that they did were corrupt. They used to fix jobs for people on Liverpool Council when ordinary people were lining up in queues to get a job as, say, a school caretaker. Now, that is corruption of the highest order.
In February 1985, as Liverpool faced financial crisis, the City Council was investigated by Kinnock's Chief of Staff. He met the militant leaders Tony Mulhern and Derek Hatton.
They urged me not to meet many of the people that I in fact was going to meet. They were anti-party elements, they were terrible people in various ways. And there was a real mood of intimidation. Intimidation is the only word that can be used about the way that many of the ordinary voluntary groups, the church groups and so on, felt about the way in which the council was operating.
As far as we could gather, he was on a fact-finding mission. With the benefit of hindsight, it was obvious that he was coming to Liverpool to see if he could establish points of support for Kinnock against us, against the council. So clearly, at that early stage, it was obvious that Kinnock had started putting in place or preparing the ground to launch an attack upon the council.
In September 1985, the council used taxes to send out redundancy notices to its own workforce. This ploy to avoid government rate capping was a gift to the Labour leader.
I heard about it on Preston Station as I was coming back from the TUC, and I said to the people with me, I've got them, this is it. This is what I've been praying for. And so when we got to Bournemouth for the Labour Party conference, I knew exactly what I wanted to say, and I knew how I could say it.
I don't think that there...
For Kinnock, the Labour Party conference in Bournemouth in 1985 was a turning point. The militant action in Liverpool offered a chance not just to attack the Trotskyites within the party, but it also gave him the freedom to lambast the pieties of Labour's left.
You start with far-fetched resolutions. They're then pickled into a rigid dogma, a code. And you go through the years sticking to that, outdated, misplaced, irrelevant to the real needs, and you end in the grotesque chaos of a Labour Council, hiring taxis to scuttle around the city, handing out redundancy notices to its own workers. telling you, no matter how entertaining, how fulfilling the short-term egos...
And Eric Heffer stood up, and he walked off the platform, and the theatre was magnificent. They played exactly into the hands of Neil Kinnock, in fact, because they were able to dramatise by that the whole way in which it went forward. And Neil, in fact, continued and delivered his speech word for word as it had been intended to be delivered.
I'm telling you, you can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services.
Conference, I think, was like a great animal. It emitted a curious sound, as though it had been wounded by an unknown cause. It didn't know what had happened to it. And it sort of groaned almost. It was a peculiar noise it made.
We were absolutely outraged. Probably two-thirds of that conference rose in condemnation of that speech. And unanimously, the Labour group in Liverpool condemned the speech. Because what it was regarded as was the most treacherous act of betrayal, probably by any Labour leader since Macdonald joined the Tories in 1931. And that will live in the memories forever.
For Neil Kinnock, Bournemouth marked the moment of his initiation into the ranks of the right of the party. He'd come out openly and forthrightly against a section of the left. For the first time, Roy Hattersley acknowledged that the party was right to prefer Kinnock as leader.
Sometimes you have to force yourself to stand up to the ovations at the end. On that occasion, I didn't. I don't believe he did it in order to become popular. I believe he did it because he wanted to put the Labour Party right, and he had a burning hatred of people who were damaging the Labour Party. But it was certainly the moment when people knew how tough he was and how determined he was.
There's one better speech to be made. It'll be the first one that I make to address the Labour Party conference as Labour Prime Minister. Yeah.
Yeah. Labour leaders at Labour Party conferences, and I think it's still the case today, have never understood that if you devote even a single paragraph of your hour-long speech to shooting at your own side, it is that which will dominate the news in the evening. And it's a simple lesson that has not yet entirely been grasped, I think, and certainly never was in Neil's time. And they confused editorials slapping in the sun, slapping Neil on the back for bashing a few Trotskyites in Liverpool over the head, with genuine popularity. But of course the sun was nowhere to be seen come the general election.
In the aftermath of Bournemouth, Labour's National Executive Committee began the process of expelling the militant tendency. Suspected militant activists were summoned to party headquarters to be questioned, and if membership was proven, expelled. As they arrived, militant organised demonstrations of support. For many on the left, like David Blunkett, this was a turning point. They could either pragmatically follow Kinnock, or they could resist expulsions in the name of freedom of speech and belief.
It was a difficult period because I was breaking with people who still believed that militant tendency weren't a threat, who still believed that they were good socialists, who still believed that because they'd done one or two things in Liverpool which were undoubtedly beneficial to the community, that somehow we should pat them on the head and patronise them and say there's nothing to worry about. It was difficult personally and it was difficult politically, but it had to be done. It had to be done in order to save the left of the Labour Party. Otherwise, I think we'd have been completely wiped out. And to play a mainstream role, to be able to influence events around us, was what we came into politics to achieve. If we'd wanted to be on the sidelines watching from the outside, we'd have joined another political party.
And what will you be how will you be voting?
Well, I don't think demonstrations of this sort actually assist in dealing with the issues rationally and objectively.
What happens in politics is there is a sort of ballast vote which swings to the ruling or majority opinion, and that has always been the case. Sometimes they're called fair-weather friends, but they're people who are unaccountably attracted to the strength of the current leader. Used to have said of Mussolini, he always rushed to the help of the victor. And so that is the that is a part of the political process. It's not surprising in any way.
Many former left-wing associates of Tony Benn and his ally Dennis Skinner chose to switch their support to Neil Kinnock on the National Executive Committee.
When I was on the NEC, if I came to the NEC and I didn't vote the Benn Skinner way, I was made to feel very, very uncomfortable by both Benn and Skinner. And the message would go back into my union that I was some kind of class traitor because I happened to disagree with them at the NEC. Now Neil Kinnock saw that and he didn't like it. And it was a very, very restricted and bad kind of politics. Not that far away from the stuff that the militant tendency were into. So it was a very tense time, and you had to be very brave, actually, to walk through the up the steps of Walworth Road past a crowd of 200 or 300 people, many of whom wouldn't be in the militant tendency but just didn't like the idea of expelling what they used to say were good socialist comrades from the Labour Party.
Throughout 1985 and 86, Labour's National Executive Committee sat through hours of hearings. It was the start of a process which would lead to the expulsion of more than 200 militants. For Neil Kinnock, it was a personal crusade.
The main antagonist, he was a bit like Vyshinsky, who was Stalin's trial lawyer, was none the less than Neil Kinnock himself. It was Kinnock who kept the whole thing going on the basis of his questions and his charges and his innuendo. And that lasted several hours.
Derek Hatton, the deputy leader of Liverpool Council, appeared to revel in the publicity.
We were at Walworth Road and we were waiting for the National Executive Committee to decide whether or not they were going to take our hearing. We had many, many supporters outside, and we were in a room where there was a window. The window opened and we were able to actually tell our supporters where we were up to at that point in time, and obviously tell the press as well.
That would be more of an indication to the NEC than the editorials of the Mail and the Express.
I was initially horrified that they had been given access to an open window and seemed to be holding a public sort of press conference broadcasting to the entirety of South London. With all the pictures and all the negative fallout that would flow from that. But that was the sort of guerrilla tactics that they were engaged in.
It was probably one of the most unpleasant experiences of my life. These people were brought in and they were defending their position. And it was probably the nearest thing to the Inquisition that I've ever attended. And, of course, they weren't then tortured on the rack, but they were expelled. And many of them were very good people.
Get to come here, what we stand for here.
Militant became Labour's obsession. Once more, the party seemed more concerned with its own affairs than the business of opposition.
The difference between Neil and Mrs. Thatcher is that Mrs. Thatcher, she never got publicly involved in internal disputes within the Conservative Party. She talked to the nation, selling whatever message it was, often quite simple slogans repeated endlessly. But always she was addressing the nation, and Neil spent all that time talking to the Labour Party. And it wasn't surprising that we didn't have much luck convincing the nation.
But the leadership was intent on reaching out to the voters. In November 1985, Peter Mandelson, a young and ambitious television producer, joined the party as director of communications. His brief, The Relaunch of Labour.
It was a bit like swimming through treacle. I sat in a room, a tiny office at the time, in front of a desk with three legs, a chair that was so wobbly I always felt as if I was sliding off it. I remember a dying plant behind me. I mean, the atmosphere was not great. And I found myself constantly knocking my head against what seemed to be a brick wall of sort of total incomprehension. What I was saying, that things that were accepted in the outside world as completely natural, normal and axiomatic were seen in the culture of the Labour Party at that time as sort of really very odd and slightly threatening.
Something which some of us already knew is that we are not doing enough in...
Mandelson quickly gained the trust of the leader and became part of the inner circle.
Inclined to give Neil Kiddock the benefit of the doubt.
134. A by-election victory was credited to his skills. Neil Kinnock gave his team a free hand.
And I left the champagne at home.
Neil just started from the assumption that really just about everything that had been done in the 83 election was a disaster, a shambles, unprofessional, ghastly. So we weren't looking back, really. I mean, we just took for granted, you know, we weren't going to do any of that.
Image became everything. In 1986, Neil Kinnock ordered a new symbol, a rose, for the party. The rose was to replace the red flag, which had been considered too revolutionary for Thatcher's Britain.
Peter went around looking at different drawings of roses and brought me drawings and so on. And then we eventually picked one, which is a fairly natural representation of a rose.
Would you object massively if I took the films off?
We actually had a serious discussion about the length of the stem. I still think it's too long.
It became known as the Red Rose Revolution. The emphasis was on packaging. Policy could be left to another day.
It was said that we were never knowingly under-launched, which I think was a fair criticism in order to grab the attention of the press. We had to kind of tell the story again and again in new forms. And I think it reached its height at that conference, which I think worked very well. We had a new logo, a new set, and we ended the conference with producing a soprano singing the red flag.
The people's flag is deep and bright, is fallen on the water dead.
I brought on a box of red roses. They happened to be there. They were left on the side of the stage. They were meant to be in people's buttonholes or decorating some parts of the stage or the conference hall, and they were just lying there with nothing more to do. So I thought, well, what a waste. So I took them on, put them onto the stage behind Neil and Glenys, and asked them if they could make any use of these, and they did, with great gusto and enthusiasm.
I had a lot of criticisms to make about it because it seems to me we were more caught up with image than substance, and that I've always been in politics to talk about ideas and how we change them. And whilst we were doing some of that, the greater attention had almost moved to winning by sound bites on radio and television and the picture spot and all those kind of things, and the rose was just put part of that image. I mean, I love roses. I grow them in my own garden, but I prefer them in the garden rather than on my lapel.
Neil Kinnock was in his element. His boisterous spirit revelled in the new exuberance. But more sober colleagues found the theatricals hard to bear.
I wasn't at all comfortable with throwing red carnations to conference. I wasn't at all comfortable at community singing at the end. But I had the sense to know that modern politics had to be like that. I'd been to the last five Democratic conventions in the United States. And you can't get away in democratic politics, particularly if you're a radical party, not an establishment party, without reaching out to people in that way. It's not the sort of politics that attracts me the most, but it's like being a doctor. Sometimes you have to perform operations that you find slightly distasteful, but you have to do it to get the patient right. Neil took the performance of politics more seriously than I've ever been able to. As the years have gone by, I've got more and more impatient with the performance of politics.
The happy pair left the 86 conference in classic style, but the left were disgusted, and Tony Benn reworked the party's anthem.
The people rose in shades of pinks, gets up my nostrils and it stinks, but ere our limbs grow stiff and cold, that old red flag we shall unfold.
I've often said that if this process continues, you won't have an annual conference Labour Party. You'll have a convention like the American Democratic Party. People won't come with resolutions, but with balloons, and they'll release their balloons, and the leadership will decide the policy. And that was an early indication, I think, of the attempt to blank out any participation by the membership of the party, because they were there as a fan club. Give us money and do what you're told and go and do a little bit of canvassing. I don't think they believe that's very necessary, and we will get there.
The left retained a power base in London, but at Greenwich, a by-election with a left-wing candidate, Deirdre Wood, was lost to the SDP. In the run-up to the general election, the memories of Labour's internal divisions once more came to the fore, and the radical policies of Labour-controlled local authorities were linked to those of the party.
Let us be clear that because of our defeat in Greenwich, because of the huge unpopularity of the London Labour Party and councils like Liverpool and the whole of that baggage that we carried from the so-called loony left, we started the 1987 election not just behind the Conservatives but behind the Liberal Democrat Social Democrat Alliance as well. That was what our private polls were telling us.
Ladies and gentlemen, Roy Hattersley, Deputy Leader, Neil Kinnock, Leader of the Labour Party.
In May 1987, Margaret Thatcher called an election. The Labour Party was ready. The campaign's opening was worlds away from the disaster of the 83 election. The Liberal SDP alliance could not compete with Labour's campaign. For the first time, the Labour leader had his own aircraft. The leader's team were sensitive to Kinnock's growing difficulties with the press. To escape the close attentions of Fleet Street, he was sent on a tour of the regions where he could indulge his natural ebullience.
The extraordinary thing about that 87 campaign and the success of that 87 campaign was that within a couple of days we'd effectively wiped out the Liberals, and the whole danger of the campaign being about third place disappeared completely almost before that story got off the ground. And it then became a battle for first place, which is what it was always, you know, intended to be and should have been. And we secured not just the second place, but we actually secured the survival of the Labour Party.
As time passed, many saw two rival sides in Neil Kinnock's personality. On the one hand, the man his advisers felt he ought to be, the sober-suited scourge of the left, and on the other, the fun-loving extrovert, ready to sing and dance at the drop of a hat. An intensely physical man, he trusted the emotions rather than the intellect.
When the election was declared in 1987, you could almost see the relief that he suddenly felt. I can now do what I was elected to do, which is campaign throughout the country and show them what I'm made of and show them what a Labour government will be like. And he made a brilliant speech in Llandudno, I think, that's where it was, at the beginning of that campaign, which suddenly revealed a Neil Kinnock from whom all the cares and the tribulations of being leader of the opposition had fallen, and there he was his own man and could do what he was good at.
I think the youngsters I meet, 3, 4, 5 years out of school, never had a job, and they say to me, do you think we'll ever get a job? These are young men and women living in a free country, but they don't feel free. I think of the 55-year-old...
The decision had been made to make Kinnock the focus of the campaign. The Labour Party commissioned Hugh Hudson, a British Oscar winner, to make a promotional video.
It was put together like a news programme, really. It was put together as we went along. And since the opening speech of the election was the one up in Anglesey, that speech was so powerful. When you were there, you could just feel it in the hall. You know, people were incredibly moved by it. It was evident that could be a central part of the 10-minute broadcast.
I threw the notes away and said what I was thinking. And they filmed it. And Hugh turned it into a brilliant representation of not only what I stood for, but what I think the Labour Party stands for.
Why am I the first Kinnock in 1,000 generations to be able to get the university? Why is Glenys the first woman in her family in 1,000 generations to be able to get the university? Was it because all our predecessors were thick? Did they lack talent? Those people who could sing and play and recite and write poetry? Those people who could make wonderful, beautiful things with their hands? Those people who could dream dreams? But why didn't they get it? It was because there was no platform upon which they could stand.
When I saw it, I was enthralled, frankly. I didn't think that politics could be delivered with such accuracy and such impetus, because Hume mixed in the considerations of policy and my speech with short interviews with my relatives and people who'd known me many years and so on.
When he became a member of Parliament, his grandfather, Mary's father, said, "That's all very well, my boy, but don't forget that MP means a man of principle."
Neil had a tear about it at the time, because he felt so emotionally moved by it, and he wanted his parents to see it, because he felt the loss of his parents very deeply. And I think he just felt that it did say something about him as a warm-loving man, and I just think he wished that his mum and dad could have shared that. So it was quite a moving experience, as it happens.
My instincts, when I heard and had described to me the party political broadcast, with everybody clapping and cheering at the end of it, was a terrible sick feeling inside. And I said to those around me, to Tom Sawyer, now the General Secretary of the party, "Am I the only one in the room who doesn't think that that is a winner?" And I was. As it happens, we won the campaign in 1987. If you like, the pools panel in football terms awarded us a 10-0 victory, but the electorate awarded the Tories an 11-0 victory, because what we were doing was appealing to those around us in the media who judged that our campaign, that the party political of Neil and Glynis walking along the cliff tops, was a superb piece of presentation. It was. It didn't win us a single extra vote.
The focus was always Kinnock. The image makers, try as they might, could not repress his character and recreate him as a presidential figure.
It was his human side. It was the fact that he was a very warm human man and could behave, and did behave, in an outrageous and unorthodox manner.
Love me, love my dog. Yes, imagine. Lovely.
And I think what people thought, the people who advised him, was that isn't acceptable for a potential prime minister. And I think it probably isn't. And that's why I think everybody liked John Smith, because he was like a Scottish bank manager. And they liked Tony Blair because he looks like a Oxbridge lawyer. But what did Neil Kinnock look like? Well, he looked too much like one of them. Okay. He was too ordinary. And they were trying to address that, I think, when they were dealing with Neil's image, but I guess it backfired in some ways.
Neil became very bad in the television studio. He was told that he had to acquire gravitas. My image of him would be of his sitting ramrod stiff with a fixed expression on his face, waiting for the first trial, as it were, the test to begin, the first question to be asked.
I still don't understand, what did that quote mean exactly about "I would die for my country, but I wouldn't want my country to die for me"? Everyone is puzzled over it. Yes. What did it mean exactly?
It's a stark way of demonstrating that the considerations that must affect us in the nuclear age are rather different from those that have affected every previous generation of people, and a stark way of demonstrating that the considerations that must affect us in the nuclear age are rather different from those that have affected every previous generation of people and of political leaders.
The newspapers were quick to seize on Kinnock's confusion over defence, perhaps the most obvious policy pitfall, but tax was to follow. 5 days before polling, Roy Hattersley, the deputy leader and shadow chancellor, met Neil Kinnock for an emergency session. Some of Kinnock's pronouncements during television interviews had sown the seeds of confusion over tax policy. Hattersley was anxious to put things right.
I don't think Neil's attitude to policy was fundamentally different from mine. I think the difference between Neil and I was that he always felt a need to demonstrate how well he understood the policy. I remember saying to him, it's better to be thought a stupid prime minister than a clever leader of the opposition. And sometimes we'll just have to let things hang in the air. And
this is why I think there's some confusion over Labour's policy towards taxation.
That's
in any
exactly
way,
exactly what I said a moment ago.
Yes, and so Mr. Gould said he couldn't make that guarantee.
But I'm sure it's good entertainment for Saturday night. But first you try to drive a wedge between me and Mr. Gould for saying one thing. Now you try to drive a wedge between Mr. Kinnock and me for saying what you now agree I
Mr.
said.
Mr. Hattersley,
it's all trivial stuff, Mr. Lewis. You ought to be in the entertainment business.
And if some Martin Lewis, whoever happens to be the commentator, gives us a hard time about it. Well, we're like a boxer in a corner. We've just got to hide behind our hands. We can't risk punching him in a way which may enable somebody to knock us out later. Neil found it difficult to resist the temptation to demonstrate that he knew what was going on. And he always did know what was going on.
On the Monday before polling, the Labour Party held its final rally in Islington, North London. Labour had made Neil Kinnock the centre of the campaign. But his exuberant style was both his greatest asset and his Achilles heel. His enemies found him all too easy to attack.
The real case against Neil, enunciated by the right-wing press, was not that he was intellectually lightweight, which in my view was nonsense. Was a sort of educational and social snobbery. In the end, they could not quite see a Welsh working class lad with speaking in a gruff, macho sort of Welsh lilt as Prime Minister. And in a way, and this is the sadness of it, in a way they may just about have been right. It's arguable, at any rate, that he could never quite deliver the appeal to that further margin, that extra 5% of the voters, who would always, in an English middle-class sense, I think always hold it against him that he was Welsh and working class.
Because I know what would have happened if I'd got words out of place, if I'd demonstrated more vitality, let's put it like that. Because, see, one person's mobilizing articulation is another person's windbaggery. And don't forget, I was the Welsh windbag.
Only 90 hours. 90 hours of Thatcherism to go.
I knew from the private polling as well as the published polling that we weren't going to win the election. I knew it, and I could also feel it. It was my judgment.
Good evening and welcome to election night. It's all over at last. The polling stations closed just a moment ago.
As the polls closed, some BBC journalists predicted a very close result.
When I got a call in my office at Walworth Road from Vincent Hanna, if I remember, saying to me in very sort of quiet and suggestive tones that things were really looking very, very good and that we could put Plan B into operation. I, first of all, didn't have the faintest idea what he meant by Plan B, and I politely pressed him and he said, Buckingham Palace. And I thought that straight away that this is the sort of chap who, when he's not phoning you, is writing letters to you in green ink. And I asked him, thanked him for his trouble, but asked him not to pass all this on to Neil Kinnock. Wasn't fair, raising his hopes, which I knew would be dashed. Unfortunately, he ignored my advice, but it was fanciful.
At Walworth Road, the Labour Party headquarters, party workers and supporters were slow to face up to the magnitude of the defeat as the results came through. In 1987, a time of economic prosperity for many, Labour's preoccupation with poverty and unemployment seemed unappealing.
the electorate were actually travelling with Mrs. Thatcher. I mean, the majority of voters were actually going her way. They were going down what I saw as a kind of selfish, individualistic, non-caring path.
Margaret Hilda Thatcher. 21,000.
I thought that they were wrong and they would come back and see the error of their ways, but in fact they didn't. And what we had to do was find a new project which connected the aims and values of Labour with the aspirations of people, some of which were kind of Thatcherite aspirations.
Mrs. Thatcher won with a majority of 102. Labour had reduced her huge majority by a mere 42.
I think from 83 to 87, Neil was very alert to these changes that were happening in the political context. I think, however, he felt that they were to be negotiated in some way. I think he still felt a sense of obligation to those who'd elected him. He saw himself as coming from the left. He remained true to a lot of the principle, the doctrine that he'd grown up with. And it was only after 1987, when we still lost, that I think he seriously began to think that fundamental change was required.
You cannot have policies that, however appealing they are to you, are completely alien to very substantial sections of the population, and you cannot hope simply with a flourish that people will forget a deep-rooted memory they had of misconduct, division and stupidity just a few years before.
The Rose had not brought victory. Labour was to remain in impotent opposition while Margaret Thatcher continued with her mission: the destruction of socialism in Britain forever. Neil Kinnock, isolated in defeat and scarred by the experience of leadership, felt he had no alternative but to move with the tide of the times and take his party further to the right.